Good morning.
Welcome to Seven's special rolling coverage of the Queen's death and the ascension of King Charles III.
The grief and sense of loss at the Queen's passing is very real, it's very raw. Her Majesty's being mourned and that pain will stay well beyond her funeral.
But with a new monarch taking the throne, there's an air of change. This is a live shot of Buckingham Palace, where Charles stepped out for the first time as king to a rousing reception. He met with fans and shared memories in an impromptu appearance before starting more formal matters.
Now, understandably, it has been a momentous 24 hours for the royal family and, by extension, Britain, the Commonwealth, and many parts of the world. Right now, preparations are underway to begin a final tour for Queen Elizabeth.
Europe Bureau Chief Hugh Whitfield begins our coverage from outside Balmoral in the Scottish Highlands.
This was a day the King said he was dreading. It began as his first full day on the throne here at Balmoral before, together with the Queen Consort Camilla, their Majesties travelled down to London to be greeted by thousands of people outside Buckingham Palace. These were remarkable scenes. The King and the Queen Consort emerging from the Royal Rolls Royce to shake hands, to speak with those people who'd gathered there, to not just mourn the Queen, but also welcome the King back to London. At one point, one woman kissed King Charles before the King and the Queen Consort walked inside Buckingham Palace, and the King headed for the blue drawing room to record an address to this nation and people right around the world, praising the service of his mother and committing himself to a lifetime of duty.
Queen Elizabeth was a life well lived, a promise with destiny kept, and she is mourned most deeply in her passing. That promise of lifelong service I renew to you all today.
In that address, the King created his son William and his wife Catherine as the new Prince and Princess of Wales. They are lofty titles that are not automatic on the demise of a sovereign, but they are in the gift of the King. And he will be aware of the weight that those titles carry, with William and Catherine speaking through sources to say they are focused on deepening the trust and the respect of the people of Wales over time. Princess Catherine saying that she appreciates the history but wants to create her own path. She is aware that the most recent Princess of Wales was Diana. Across town at St Paul's Cathedral, a service of thanksgiving for the life of Queen Elizabeth, with senior politicians including the Prime Minister Liz Truss attending. Earlier, the new Prime Minister had been at Buckingham Palace, the King's first audience with the Prime Minister. Of course, Liz Truss is new in the job this week, as is King Charles, and he spoke of his true feelings of the day.
But it's been so touching this afternoon when we arrived here. All those people had come to give their condolences. It's the moment I've been dreading, as I know a lot of people have, but try and keep everything going.
The King spending his first night on the throne tonight at Buckingham Palace with the Queen Consort.
A special service has been held at St Paul's Cathedral in London, where we heard God Save the King sung for the first time in 70 years.
It gave a handful of mourners the opportunity to pay their respects to Queen Elizabeth. Among them, our Europe correspondent Sarah Greenalt.
Well, it was only earlier this summer in June that members of the royal family, the extended family, dignitaries, the then Prime Minister Boris Johnson and others all gathered here at St Paul's Cathedral in central London for a service of thanksgiving for the Queen's reign during her Platinum Jubilee celebration. No one at that point dared to believe or wanted to believe that an evening like this of prayer and reflection after the Queen's passing would be necessary just 3 months on. This was really the first formal event to mourn the loss of the Queen since the news broke that she had passed away, and it was very much a night for the public. There were 2,000 seats available to everyday Brits, and as you can imagine, those tickets went very, very quickly, with people filing up, queuing to get inside. There was a quite lovely sermon delivered by the Bishop of London. She started it by saying that a life lived in the service of others is a jewel Queen Elizabeth wore as a crown, an extraordinary life dedicated to others. She added that as we are giving thanks for the Queen's life, we are mourning her loss, and we are also reorientating ourselves as individuals, and as a nation without Her Majesty. A really poignant line there. We have spoken to some of the people who were lucky enough to get a ticket to this service. Here's what they had to say.
I thought the speech by Prince Charles was fantastic, and it was really poignant to be singing the national anthem saying, God save our king, which is the first time I've obviously ever done that.
With the Queen going, it just seems like an era has ended. And with King Charles now, there will be a change, but we have to just follow what the King has for us and what the country has for us.
So I think it's a really wonderful thing that they let so many people, you know, they let 2,000 just ordinary members of the public come and be part of it, which is really special. So, yeah, very much a reflection on the Queen and her life, but also obviously at the beginning we heard from the now King Charles, which we're all very much still getting used to.
This service was so special to so many people for several reasons, including for the fact that it had the first rendition of God Save the King, the first official rendition, that is. I'm sure we will hear plenty more of that over the next weeks, months, years to come, but especially over the next 10 days or so in this official mourning period for the nation as the Queen farewells, remembers Her Majesty and welcomes the new King.
Sarah Greenodge there. Well, let's go live to Jennifer Beshwati at Parliament House in Canberra, where politicians have showed their respects this morning. Jen, hello to you. A very touching moment there.
Yeah, it really was. A couple of hours ago, a moving ceremony here at Parliament House at the Queen's Terrace. The Governor-General David Hurley, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese, Opposition Leader Peter Dutton and many other members of Parliament all laying a wreath at Her Majesty's statue on the Queen's Terrace. Now, that statue was in fact unveiled by Her Majesty herself on the 9th of May in 1988, when she officially opened the building. Now, the floral arrangements that were placed there by the Prime Minister and Governor General are made with yellow wattle, which also featured in the famous Australian portrait of the Queen. On there was a note that read, "With deepest sympathy." Now, the Prime Minister spoke briefly following the ceremony. Here's what he had to say.
There have been many moving tributes to the contribution of Queen Elizabeth, but none more so than from King Charles III. King Charles, of course, was paying tribute not just to the sovereign, but to his beloved mother. And it was extraordinarily fitting words. It struck me in particular that his words, where he said, "The affection, admiration and respect she inspired became the hallmark of her reign." And that's why so many Australians have made moving tributes and are mourning this enormous loss. And I again reiterate, on behalf of the people of Australia, our sympathy for the royal family, for their personal loss, as well as to the people of the United Kingdom and the people of the Commonwealth in particular, but also the whole world, for what is an enormous loss.
And Jen, what are the Prime Minister's plans from here?
Well, so the big day in Parliament is tomorrow. The flags outside will return to full mast just for tomorrow, and that is when the Prime Minister will recommend that the Governor-General issue the proclamation of accession. That will officially recognise King Charles III as Australia's new head of state. That will happen outside Parliament at 11 a.m. Members of the public are welcome to watch that ceremony. There will also then be a 21-gun salute in honour of His Majesty on the forecourt. Now, in the coming days, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese will travel to London with his partner Jodie Hayden. They will attend the lying in state at Westminster Hall and will also attend Her Majesty's funeral. Whilst there, Mr. Albanese is also expected to have a brief audience with King Charles III. He will meet with the new Prime Minister, Liz Truss. In fact, he spoke with Liz Truss last night and offered condolences on behalf of Australia to the British people, guys.
Yeah, Jen, busy schedule abroad. What is planned for the country when the PM returns to Australia?
Well, when he comes back, preparations are already underway for a national memorial service and a national day of mourning. On the day of mourning, there will be a minute's silence at 11 a.m. Now, the date is yet to be set for both the memorial service and the day in mourning, but discussions are underway as to whether that becomes a public holiday. The Prime Minister, many members of Parliament, premiers, many dignitaries and other members of the public are all invited to attend the memorial service. In terms of protocols, well, as you can see there, here in the Parliament House, there is a condolence book where members of the public can line up and sign that. We're also in the middle of a sitting fortnight. That, of course, is not going to continue. Parliament has been suspended for 15 days. That will be rescheduled. When politicians do return to Parliament, of course, there will be it will be a day filled with condolence motions for the Queen. For Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. So formalities will continue for many days. Her Majesty left an incredible mark here in Australia. Many will want to honour her legacy. Guys.
All right, Jen. Thank you for that from Canberra today.
You're watching 7 News and our continuing coverage of the death of Queen Elizabeth II.
During her 70 years on the throne, the Queen managed to bridge a lot of generations, a constant as the world changed around us.
Now that she is gone and Charles is king, can the monarchy adapt to the challenges of today? Here's NBC reporter Molly Hunter from London.
I speak to you today.
For King Charles III, the challenge is clear.
All just feels very different. It feels very final now.
We've all known just one queen. She's a person we've always looked up to.
With a new prime minister, an energy crisis looming, inflation making life harder here, the country is anxious.
I think the next 2 or 3 weeks that follow this give some strange times, not only for England or Britain, but for all Commonwealth countries.
While Queen Elizabeth was widely beloved and respected, her eldest son has never enjoyed that kind of popularity.
We need some direction as probably a country where we're going to go, but whether or not we have a suitable leader in the future, let's see how it unfolds.
Yeah. Do you think the king has it in him? What would you like to see from him?
I hope they'll try and modernise the royalty.
And part of modernising will be slimming down. The taxpayer tolerance for funding the monarchy is waning.
Do you believe the royal family should continue in its current way?
Not in the current way as it's going, but probably in a lower status, going down a little bit, yeah. Okay. Cutting down on those expenses, cutting down on us, funding for them.
And bringing his more popular son, his heir William, now Prince of Wales, and wife Kate, into the fold as soon as possible may endear him to a modern Briton.
I think he needs to be way more inclusive, more diverse, reach out to people, like especially in this time of need, that are on like really low.
Also focusing on issues like climate change, which he's championed for years, that resonate with young people.
I think the Queen's always been really impartial, so it'd be interesting to see whether Charles takes a slightly more bolder stance on issues than the Queen has in the past.
It would also connect him more to the younger generation, to a modern Britain.
Well, if he focuses on climate change, I think definitely.
Some interesting views on the street there in London. Well, the Queen's love affair with Balmoral dated back to her own honeymoon. She and Prince Philip spent years of it there, and over the years, it offered the privacy other royal residents just didn't. The Queen didn't simply hide away there.
She liked to be involved in the life of rural Aberdeenshire. She was known to go shopping in the nearby village. It's no wonder then the people who live there are missing her so much.
Nestled amid the forests and glens just beyond Balmoral, the village of Ballater has cherished and been cherished by the royal family for generations. And every summer, there was one visitor welcomed above all others. A very familiar face in the local shops.
She would pop in and say hello at the time she did come in. We just thought she was our neighbour. When she came into the town, the buzz got around, she was in town, maybe doing a bit of shopping. People just left her to get on with it.
Now, as the world mourns, this small village remembers with pride its special relationship with the late Queen.
I met the Queen 3 weeks ago. We were at Balmoral. I knew she looked a bit frail, but to get the shock of the news yesterday just floored a whole lot of us. Today, the community is saddened, but this community will get together and support the new king when he arrives.
Others shared her faith and will seek strength in that. Reverend David Barr has opened the church for the community to mourn.
I'm a boy from the east end of Glasgow. I was an ex-marine in the Majesty's forces, 6'3". And when I came down to ring the church bell 70 times for each year that she reigned, I was up in the tower, crying my eyes out. She'd been a major part of our lives.
And it just feels as like elsewhere in the world, this community is reflecting on what Queen Elizabeth brought to them.
She was our beacon of hope. She was our steadfast anchor in rough seas, and she was our constant, always with compassion and always with grace. We can't ask for any more than that, not at all. And she gave it happily.
Oh. It's quite heartbreaking, wasn't it? Yeah. Live to Annie Puller at New South Wales Government House in Sydney. Annie, how's it looking there today?
Good morning, Ange. Well, as you can see, this floral tribute behind me is growing bigger and brighter by the hour. It's been an incredibly beautiful, sunny morning here at Government House. We've already seen hundreds of mourners turn out with bouquets of flowers bigger than what they can handle and placing them here at the gates, along with many sentimental and heartfelt messages of support and love to Queen Elizabeth. You can see one of them reads here, "My Queen, RIP, thank you for your hard work." That was a family that placed that message. And what's so incredible about standing here this morning is just the generations the Queen has touched. We've seen kids as young as 5 years old. We've seen families. We've seen seniors. We know the Queen played a pivotal role in shaping our state. You know, she was here for some milestone major events, including the opening of the Sydney Opera House. Of course, Darling Harbour, she had 12 visits in total to New South Wales, 16 in Australia. And being here this morning, Ange, there is a real sort of surrealness. I mean, so many people are so saddened by the loss of the Queen, but there is a sense of celebration. There's many people that have been speaking of their adoration for Queen Elizabeth, of her courage, of her strength, of her commitment to service. And we know she had that cheeky side as well. I have just been in Government House earlier. I'm told the New South Wales Governor will be touching down in Sydney tomorrow morning. She'll be straight down to business, chairing an Executive Council meeting before heading over to Parliament House, where King Charles will be sworn in. I'll take you along just to see some of these incredible bouquets that have been placed here. You can get such a sense of love that people in New South Wales have had for the Queen. We are also seeing a police presence here. We know that we are expecting crowds possibly later this afternoon. So police are here keeping an eye out, making sure everybody is safe. But certainly a beautiful, touching tribute unfolding at Government House this morning, Ange. We'll have more to come as the afternoon unfolds.
Welcome back to our special coverage of Queen Elizabeth's passing. Right now we're looking at live pictures there of the Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau signing a condolences book.
As we know, yesterday's speech that he gave was quite emotional. He was extremely moved by the Queen's passing and said he had an extremely fond and close relationship with her. So no doubt reflecting that in what he's writing there right now.
Yes, also. And no doubt one of many world leaders who will be heading over to London for the funeral shortly. King Charles III has been given a warm welcome by his new subjects as he returned to London following his mother's death in the Scottish Highlands.
He took part in an impromptu meet and greet outside Buckingham Palace, shaking hands and sharing memories as thousands gathered outside the gates. Here's Ashley Mullaney.
Well, it was the Queen that said in a speech to Parliament back in 2002 that change is a constant, and this is a country and Commonwealth grappling with a seismic change. In much the same way that Queen Elizabeth was able to capture the mood of the nation and read the mood of the nation, so too was Charles today. And I think that's exactly what we saw when he stepped down to shake the hands of those who had come here to pay their respects to Queen Elizabeth, all at a time when he too is mourning the loss of his mother. Those who we spoke to here today said they were remembering Queen Elizabeth as someone who was devoted to her country and sense of duty and stoic too.
She dedicated her life to service, and that was just such a core backbone and the stability, and I just, Yeah, it feels strange. She's been with us my whole lifetime.
And we were flying over when she passed away and we heard the news, and it was announced on the plane. So, yeah, very moving.
We saw some poignant moments too out at Windsor Castle, a place that the Queen loved to spend time and spent a lot of time in the last few years during COVID and the last few years with Prince Philip too. Speaking to locals out there, they said that this wasn't just losing the Queen, they were losing someone who they considered a neighbour too.
Leaders from around the world are preparing to fly to the UK for Her Majesty's funeral. Tim Lester is in a US bureau. Tim, what more are we learning?
Well, Ange, we've learned from President Biden today that he certainly intends to go. He also said he didn't know yet the details for the funeral, but he very much plans to be there. In fact, there's been speculation in the United States that the living presidents, all of them, might even try to attend because they all knew her. In fact, of the last 14 US presidents, 13 of them met with her. Lyndon Baines Johnson, president during the Vietnam War in the mid-1960s, being the one exception, and she even met World War II President Harry Truman when she was a princess in London. So her connection with the US and the US presidents is pretty strong, and so you might not simply see Joe Biden there. There'll be the question of Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, Donald Trump, the Obamas, and the current president going along as well. Other world leaders also talking about her today. Quite emotional. Emmanuel Macron, the French president, speaking in English notably and making what was a very strong point, I think, when he said to the British people in English, well, you saw her as your queen, we saw her as the queen. And a lot of that sentiment has come from around the world, the extent to which somehow they felt a connection with Queen Elizabeth II. Somehow people well beyond Britain, with very little to do with Britain, felt she somehow represented them as well.
What an amazing line by the French president. She was the queen. That's really, that's very, very strong. Tim, in your years in Canberra and covering major political events and conferences and all sorts of G-level meetings around the world, you've seen the security that comes with getting world leaders together. So for this funeral, you've got possibly, definitely one president from the United States, possibly other living ones, leaders of France, Australia, Canada, a long list of world leaders, dignitaries, diplomats. It is going to be an incredible security operation in London in the week ahead.
An absolutely giant security operation, Michael, and a giant logistics operation. Security certainly goes to the logistics problem, complicates them greatly. But yes, it is going to be an enormous occasion. But what stands out, I think, is it is an occasion where political leaders, particularly from democracies where they know the public sentiment towards the Queen, they'll want to be there. They'll want to be there and they'll want to be prominent and they'll want to be saying to their people at home, I'm representing you, I'm turning up, I'm seeing and seen there. So you won't keep them away.
No way.
But organising them is going to be a big headache.
Tim, I'm wondering if you could just share with us what the mood is in America in terms of our new king. We have a new king now. Obviously, the Americans were very affectionate towards the Queen. How do they feel about King Charles?
Well, I think, like a lot of us, they're let's see how this goes. And I mean, they're pretty positive and pretty encouraging, if for no other reason than the goodwill they feel towards Elizabeth. It is striking, I think, for an Australian to look abroad, because we tend to think in Australia that we have a special relationship with the British monarchy, and we do at a lot of levels. But you can think that they wouldn't matter that much in the United States. They matter a lot. And this is a shock for the US and the loss of a great friend for the US, both right at the higher levels of political power in Washington and the higher diplomatic levels, but also generally for American people. They feel a connection to Elizabeth. They know Queen Elizabeth. They felt she is a constant in a changing world like so many of us. So America feels this keenly, and the former US presidents and the current one are among those who will want to be seen at her funeral and want to be seen paying respects.
Just a brief one, Tim, on the tabloid side of all of this. It's the Meghan Markle question. Obviously, she's given many interviews in America now about her view of the royal family and poor treatment from them. Yet here's this incredible outpouring and support, sympathy, love for the passing of Queen Elizabeth. I wonder what that makes of Meghan Markle's narrative at the moment.
Well, it certainly sits uneasily at the moment, and that's I think reflected in the fact that we haven't seen Meghan and probably won't for a little while. She'll be out of the limelight now, so yes, it's uncomfortable. It hasn't been getting a mention here particularly. I just think it's to American people not of that much interest. It was certainly of interest when she spoke back last March and the fuss it caused then, but it passed. And I think Americans feel a sense of dignity is needed to this, and so they're looking well beyond that. And as a simple measure of Queen Elizabeth and the respect she drew, American people are now very focused on her, her history, her connection to this country, and the way she helped maintain the alliance between two critical partners of Australia's and two key world players.
King Charles's rise to the throne has raised a number of questions about the new royal line of succession.
That's particularly the case for Harry and Meghan's children. Our correspondent Ashley Mullaney spoke with royal commentator Victoria Arbiter about what happens next for the family.
William is now the first in line to the throne. What does this mean for his responsibilities?
Well, I think the country is obviously going through a huge period of transition, but life is going to change on a personal level dramatically for the new Prince and Princess of Wales. Now, William and Kate have been so fortunate that they have been able to raise their children with William only second in line to the throne. That meant he didn't have anything like the pressure that Prince Charles had when William and Harry were born many years ago. And so I think he's going to really feel a noticeable shift in terms of his responsibilities, not just to the nation, but we have to think about the Commonwealth realms and the Commonwealth of Nations as well. Previously, we had the Queen and Prince Philip, their children, their grandchildren, and then the Queen's extended family by way of her cousins. Well, that's an elderly family now. Most of the Queen's cousins are in their late 70s, their early 80s. Princess Anne does phenomenal work, as do Edward and Sophie, and they'll certainly be there to help pick up some of the slack, but even Princess Anne is into her 70s. Royals generally don't retire. We know that because Prince Philip was in his very late 90s when he decided to take a step back for a little while. But still, this is an enormous amount of responsibility that really rests on the shoulders of Charles, Camilla, William and Kate.
And how much of a factor is it that Meghan and Harry have stepped away from the royal family and royal duties too?
Well, I think really the fact that the royal family slimmed down even before Charles's version of a slimmed down monarchy could kick in. And I mean that because Prince Andrew obviously was asked to step aside, rightly so. And then Harry and Meghan chose to step aside. That leaves a gaping hole in terms of a younger generation of royals able to carry out all of the responsibilities required by the institution of monarchy. You may remember in 2012 for the Diamond Jubilee, it was unusual, but the vision of the monarchy we saw on the balcony was the Queen. Prince Philip was sadly in hospital. Charles, Camilla, William, Kate, and Prince Harry. Had Prince Harry been married at the time, his wife would have featured too. But much was made about that being Prince Charles's version of a slimmed down monarchy for the future. Harry and his future wife were very much a part of that. They chose to remove themselves. So now William and Kate have really got an enormous burden in terms of what they are going to be responsible for, particularly because they are still parents to three young children, children that won't even be thinking about royal responsibilities for many years to come. Yes, George is being broken in ever so slowly, so is Charlotte, but George, Charlotte, Louis, they'll all go to university. George will have to complete military service in all four branches of the military. So we won't see the Cambridge, now Wales, children on a public stage in terms of official engagements for many years to come. So it'll be interesting to see how they choose to spread the load. Chances are the days of a royal having huge numbers of patronages have passed. They're simply not going to be able to oversee 800 plus organisations in the way the Queen and Prince Philip did. We're going to see them choosing much more smaller charities, places where they can really invest their focus and their interest and make a considerable difference. They're not going to be just figureheads for numerous charities anymore. But then we have to think about the Commonwealth realms. What happens to the Commonwealth of Nations in terms of international tours, foreign tours? What about on days such as Remembrance Sunday, when we have royals really travel all over the nation in order to pay their respects to veterans of the previous world wars? There's simply not going to be enough people to do the job. So it'll be interesting to see how they choose to place their focus.
And I'm interested too in the royal titles. Obviously, we have now seen the Prince and Princess of Wales. Is that correct? I believe so. I might have to double check that. But that's obviously a title change. But then also, Meghan and Harry, I've been reading that their children will now be able to take the title of Prince and Princess. Why is that?
There's a lot of title changes all at once, and this is what I mean about this huge period of change that we are witnessing. Yes, in his speech, King Charles announced that William and Kate will now be known as Prince and Princess of Wales. That was not an automatic. It was certainly an expectation, but that is in the gift from the sovereign. So I think by announcing that in the way he did, Charles was really hoping to offer some clarity, just to rid any speculation. This was all planned in advance. This was signed off on by the Queen. When it comes to Harry and Meghan's children, yes, technically, according to the letters patent issued in 1917 by George V, the grandchildren of the serving sovereign are entitled to the style HRH, Prince, Princess. So yes, technically that does apply to Archie and little Lilibet. What we don't know is that if it is retroactive, should they have been HRH, should there have been new letters patent while the Queen was still living, or is it just assumed that those titles are going to now be newly conferred? These are the types of details that are sort of going to come out, I think, as we start to embrace the changes in the coming days, weeks and months. But yes, according to the 1917 letters patent, Archie and Lilibet are HRH, Prince and Princess now. Whether Harry and Meghan want their children to have those titles and styles remains to be seen. Whether Prince Charles approves that or issues a new letters patent remains to be seen. But obviously a period of huge change and so many things still to be decided.
Stay with us. We'll be back with more of our special coverage, and we'll just have a quick look at those pictures that happened last night while we're on air. The new king and his queen consort looking at the flowers that have been left outside Buckingham Palace. This is 7 News. You're watching special coverage as the world mourns the loss of Queen Elizabeth and welcomes King Charles III.
Here are the developments as we go to air this hour. We'll catch you up on all the developments.
The new king is spending his first night as monarch at Buckingham Palace. Earlier, it was an impromptu meet and greet from Charles when he spent some time shaking hands and sharing memories with the large crowds gathered at the palace gates.
There were also the more formal meetings for King Charles, one of his first, obviously, the new Prime Minister, Liz Truss. He's delivered his first speech as well, paying tributes to his, quote, his dear mama in an emotional address.
Preparations and even this morning are happening right now for the Queen's final tour, as Buckingham Palace is calling it, her body to be taken from her home in Balmoral in the next day or so. She will travel to Edinburgh and on to London ahead of the funeral.
And as we're just looking at their tributes in Australia, that's the Governor-General there laying a wreath in Canberra with his wife Lynn, also Anthony Albanese, his partner Jodie. That was all happening at Parliament House, those formalities, embracing the new king on behalf of the Australian people. The ceremonies are to continue tomorrow.
Let's go live now to Anna McGraw at Government House in Brisbane. Anna, people have been laying flowers there this morning.
Good morning. We've seen a steady stream of people here all day, really. The gates opened at 8 o'clock this morning. It's now after lunchtime, and we've seen more than 500 people. The Governor, Jeanette Young, she was out here speaking with some of those people. They estimate that it's more than 500 at the moment, and they'll see hundreds more throughout both today and tomorrow. The people that have been coming through here have been incredibly emotional about the Queen's passing. They've been, sharing memories and stories and thoughts of Her Majesty and exactly what she meant to the people here in Brisbane. She visited Brisbane 8 times throughout her reign, the first in 1954, where she actually stayed here at Government House. And her last visit was in 2011 after our devastating flooding disaster. Take a listen to what some people have had to say.
Just her generous nature. I don't think, I certainly always thought of her as being like a grandmother figure, I guess, just always loving and caring.
Anybody else can unite so many people and expect so many people to raise themselves to be better versions.
Now, in Brisbane tomorrow, there'll be the formalities to proclaim our new king, King Charles III. That'll begin here at Government House at about 10:30, where there'll be an official statement read out, and then the Governor and the Premier will head on to Parliament House in Brisbane, where there will be a private ceremony there. But it is very clear to see here in Brisbane and across Queensland as well just how much the Queen's passing has had such an effect on the public here. It's been incredibly emotional, no matter how far away or how close you are to the palace in London. It's just clear to see that everybody is, really feeling, the Queen's passing, and it's just an incredibly emotional time for people across Australia and the Commonwealth. Guys?
Indeed it is. Okay, thanks so much, Anna. Welcome back to our special coverage on 7 News. Well, as we know, the Queen passed away peacefully at her country estate of Balmoral, which she loves so much.
And despite its remote location today, tributes are growing in the Scottish Highlands, locals showing their appreciation of their former neighbour.
We just wanted to, in our own little way, just to sort of show our respects and just to show to the family that we're thinking of them and that our prayers are with them. So we bought the flowers and the kids wanted to come along as well. Because, it's a bit of history, for the monarchy, the Queen, she meant a lot to everybody. I'm, 54, and so, growing up, I just remember, from being that age, I just remember the Queen and the royal family. The Queen is the monarch, she's the matriarch, so she's always been here. So then to suddenly hear she's not here, it's like, oh. It's like an end of an era. She's not here. She's not going to be with us anymore.
I'm getting all teary, actually. I'm Australian, and my children were born here in England. In England, not in Scotland. And she's like a grandmother, I think. She's like the grandmother that we don't have here. My parents are back home. And she's like that constant person in your life, in my whole entire life and also my parents' life, that's always been very inspirational, inspirational for a woman, but also inspirational to other leaders of the world. We just think it's such a loss for the country, and I just hope that King Charles can, even if he does half a job of what she did, I think we'd be delighted, if I'm honest, because she's so hard to live up to, and we're just really sad, if I'm honest.
Welcome back to our special coverage. Buckingham Palace has become a gathering place for thousands of Britons and tourists to gather.
Europe correspondent Sarah Greenalch has been speaking with those gathering and saying goodbye to Queen Elizabeth, as well as hoping to catch a glimpse of the new king.
I've felt that the Queen's been with me my whole life, and she's done the most incredible thing for the nation and as well as the Commonwealth. And she will be hugely missed. Her legacy and commitment to her citizens and her duty is unparalleled in history.
It's been extremely emotional. But yeah, we're looking forward to the concerts in the future that we get to do, supporting our king and everything he has to offer.
Lord, save our gracious king. Long live our noble king. God save the King, set him victorious
Thanks for your company today. This is 7 News. You're watching our special coverage, of course, as the world mourns the loss of Queen Elizabeth, welcomes King Charles III. Here are some developments as we go to air this hour.
The new king is spending his first night as monarch at Buckingham Palace. Earlier, it was an impromptu meet and greet from Charles when he spent some time shaking hands and sharing memories with the large crowds gathered at the palace gates.
Also, more formal meetings for King Charles, one of his first, the new Prime Minister Liz Truss, and he's delivered his first speech as well, paying tributes to, quote, his dear mama in an emotional address.
Preparations are happening right now for the Queen's final tour, as Buckingham Palace is calling it, her body to be taken from her home in Balmoral in the next day or two. She will travel to Edinburgh and on to London ahead of her funeral.
And tributes in Australia. The Governor-General and Anthony Albanese laying wreaths in Canberra this morning ahead of formalities at Parliament House, embracing the new king on behalf of the Australian people, and those ceremonies continue tomorrow.
Now, we are joined by two very special guests. Irene Chapman and Helen Mulligan are residents at Orange Grove Care Community. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, Irene, let's start with you. You turned 100 this year and received a letter from the Queen. You've got it there in front of you. Tell us about that moment.
Well, it was a very big thrill to have it. A very unexpected, but I did appreciate it very much.
What a wonderful thing you have there. It all framed, the actual letter and the photos there. Irene, am I right in saying that you met the Queen in 1970? How was that, if that was the case?
She came to Australia and she visited quite a lot of little places around us. And one of them was Orange, where I lived. And we seen her drive down Summer Street. Yeah, big thrill.
I'm sure it was a big thrill, absolutely.
Can I ask you, just in terms of that letter from the Queen, when you were like 98, 99, were you thinking, I've just got to hang on for 100 because I've got to get that letter from the Queen?
Yes, it was a bit like that.
Well, good on you. You made it, which is the good thing. Helen, let me ask you, what about the carriage behind you there?
Yes, I might take that for a drive. That'd be all right, wouldn't it?
Yes, it's all right.
I don't know who would pull it.
What is it about the carriage behind you? I'm trying to have a look at it there and understand what it is. Tell me about it.
Well, I can't see it from where I'm sitting.
Helen,
it's quite a glamorous carriage. Yeah.
Can you tell us a bit more about the carriage, Helen?
Yes, don't want to ride in the carriage.
Can you tell them a bit about the carriage?
Well, what's changed? Our lady artist made it, which is very, very nice. Yeah. The Queen came down Summer Street from the top end, from Duntree League end. I was working at Wantama at the time, and we all went out on the footpath and waved. The Queen was there and Philip. They were both there. So we gave them all a nice wave, and that's about it. It was very nice to see them. It was a big surprise for them to come to Orange.
Yeah.
And it was nice.
Did you think Philip was handsome?
Oh, he was.
You don't think? I didn't hear that one, sorry.
That's right, very diplomatic. I was
she
just asked.
She wanted to know, was that prince handsome?
Yes, definitely. Most definitely. Sorry.
And I think he did a wonderful job for the Queen.
But he was already taken.
Yeah.
It was quite a love they had. So, ladies, I'll ask you, Irene, how has the news of the Queen's passing affected you?
Well, it's sad, but we know she was getting old and we know she was getting very tired. And I think it's a relief, really, for everybody that she's gone.
Yeah. Yeah.
For her, yes. She's had a tremendous life, hasn't she?
She certainly has. And Helen, what do you think of King Charles?
I'll have to wait on that.
Irene's on the fence.
I don't have... I've never had much to do with Charles. He was never one of my favourites of the royal family. But I'm just hoping that he will get his act together and turn out to be okay.
There you go. I think a lot of people are probably thinking that, Irene. Really lovely of you to hold your very beautiful framed letter there from the Queen in front of you, and appreciate both of you coming and having a chat. I never thought you'd guess you'd wake up this morning and come on national TV and talk about the Queen. A bit of a surprise for
no,
you.
I never thought that. that's something very unusual.
Well, we really appreciate you talking to us. We really do.
Well, I hope I gave you some help.
Thank you, ladies.
It's been a momentous 24 hours, obviously, for the royal family and, by extension, Britain, the Commonwealth and the world. Right now, preparations are underway for a final tour, the palace's words, for Queen Elizabeth. That's how they're describing it.
Europe Bureau Chief Hugh Whitfield has more from outside Balmoral in the Scottish Highlands.
We're going to see plenty of historic moments over the course of the next 2 weeks, and today was just an entree, the first full day of King Charles' time on the throne. It began here at Balmoral before, together with the Queen Consort, their Majesties travelled to London. The new King showered in appreciation and affection. Charles III arriving home to Buckingham Palace to address the world for the first time since the death of his mother.
I speak to you today with feelings of profound sorrow. Throughout her life, Her Majesty the Queen, my beloved mother, was an inspiration, an example to me and to all my family. And we owe her the most heartfelt debt any family could owe to their mother, for her love, affection, guidance, understanding and example.
Reaffirming his intention to serve as she did.
Queen Elizabeth was a life well lived, a promise with destiny kept, and she is mourned most deeply in her passing. That promise of lifelong service I renew to you all today.
Making a heartfelt pledge of respect.
Wherever you may live in the United Kingdom or in the realms and territories across the world, and whatever may be your background or beliefs, I shall endeavour to serve you with loyalty, respect and love as I have throughout my life.
His wife Camilla, now elevated to Queen Consort.
I count on the loving help of my darling wife Camilla, in recognition of her own loyal public service since our marriage 17 years ago, she becomes my Queen Consort. I know she will bring to the demands of her new role the steadfast devotion to duty.
Prince William and his wife Kate, the new Prince and Princess of Wales, a title formerly held by Charles himself and William's mother, Princess Diana.
As my heir, William now assumes the Scottish titles, which have meant so much to me. He succeeds me as Duke of Cornwall and takes on the responsibilities for the Duchy of Cornwall, which I have undertaken for more than 5 decades. Today, I am proud to create him Prince of Wales, Tywysog Cymru, the country whose title I've been so greatly privileged to bear. With Catherine beside him, our new Prince and Princess of Wales will, I know, continue to inspire and lead our national conversations, helping to bring the marginal to the centre ground.
Harry and Meghan, not forgotten.
I want also to express my love for Harry and Meghan as they continue to build their lives overseas.
Ending his address with a thank you to his parents.
To my darling Mama, as you begin your last great journey to join my dear late Papa, I want simply to say this. Thank you. Thank you for your love and devotion to our family and to the family of nations you have served so diligently. May flights of angels sing thee to thy rest.
Afterwards, a service of prayer for the Queen at St. Paul's Cathedral.
If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's.
God Save the King, formally sung for the first time in 7 decades. Charles admitting to new British PM Liz Truss.
It's the moment I've been dreading, as I know a lot of people have, but I'm trying to keep everything going.
Come. Boris Johnson and Theresa May speaking in Parliament, reminiscing humorously about their private moments with the late Queen.
Our innocent joy, more than 10 years ago after the opening ceremony of the London Olympics, when I told her that the leader of a friendly Middle Eastern country seemed actually to believe that she had jumped out of a helicopter in a pink dress and parachuted into the stadium.
These were not meetings with a high and mighty monarch, but a conversation with a woman of experience and knowledge and immense wisdom. They were also the one meeting I went to which I knew would not be briefed out to the media.
The creation of William and Kate as the Prince and Princess of Wales is a gift of the King. It is not automatic on the demise of the sovereign, but William now will carry the title that his father carried for 53 years, and Catherine will carry the title that William's mother had, Diana. They have been speaking through sources, saying that they are focused on deepening the trust and respect of the people of Wales over time. Catherine saying that she appreciates the history but wants to create her own path. It is immediate, as soon as the King said that in his speech, that they are now the Prince and Princess of Wales, so much so that their social media handles have changed already.
Hugh Whitfield there in Balmoral. Now, the Queen's passing triggers a tightly choreographed 10 days of events, culminating in her funeral at Westminster Abbey.
So here's what will take place over the coming week and a half.
In the next 24 hours, the Queen's coffin is expected to travel from Balmoral to the nearby city of Aberdeen and then on to Holyrood Palace in Edinburgh by royal train. In Canberra, the Prime Minister will lead a meeting to consider the proclamation of the King, formalities that will see the Governor-General speak at midday alongside a 21-gun salute.
The new King will deliver his first speech as monarch to Parliament at Westminster, where MPs will move a motion of condolence. The Queen's coffin will travel up the Royal Mile in Edinburgh, leaving Holyrood Palace to St Giles Cathedral in the city. And that starts a national tour that will take in services in Belfast and Cardiff.
On day 5, the Queen is expected to arrive in London for the final time. Her coffin will be placed in the throne room in Buckingham Palace and rehearsals will begin for its procession to the Palace of Westminster.
The Queen's lying in state. This is going to be significant. We'll begin on day 6. That's in Westminster Hall. Hundreds of thousands of people expected to pay their respects over the next 4 days and say their final farewells.
World leaders will begin arriving in London for the funeral at Westminster Abbey, which is expected to take place around 9 or 10 days after the Queen's death. When her body is moved to Westminster Abbey, a national silence will fall across Britain ahead of the official proceedings. After that, a more private family service will take place at King George Chapel, where she will be laid to rest alongside her mother, the ashes of her sister, and of course, Prince Philip. Rachel Bales from the Australian Monarchist League is with us now. Thanks so much for your company. The Queen has been our head of state through some of the world's most challenging times. What sort of legacy do you think she leaves behind as a leader?
I think as a leader, the Queen leaves behind a legacy of service above self. Since the time she ascended the throne quite unexpectedly with the death of her father, she's kept calm, she's kept committed and focused to the task, and she's always put the people first. And I think that sense of always putting service above self will carry through to the legacy of the new king.
Yeah, do you think service may well make up for Charles's character in some areas that he's not as popular over his life as his mother has been, and certainly not as popular as some other royals? Do you think service will earn people's respect instead?
Yeah, and I mean, the reign of the Queen being the longest in British and Australian history, it's by nature incomparable. Of course, this will be a different reign, but I think the people of Australia are by nature very open-minded and very generous. And they've seen throughout the King's time as Prince of Wales, his commitment to not only the people of Australia, but also values that the people of Australia embrace themselves, such as the environment, the importance of youth and helping those who are disadvantaged. So I think those values will shine through and speak for themselves, and the people of Australia will really embrace this new king.
Every few years, obviously, we hear rumblings of people wanting to become a republic. There's always been some concern that with the passing of the Queen, who has just been so immensely popular, that that might trigger more momentum in that direction. Are you concerned about that?
No, I think at the moment, people, it's sort of above the debate of republic versus monarchy. It's above politics. And people are just thinking about the Queen, they're thinking about the legacy that she leaves, and really the worth of this institution, in that it's almost like we've lost a communal grandmother. So I think rather than people's minds turning to going to the polls or a referendum or a political change, people just want to sit with that gratitude and then see what this new king will make of this role.
Still, I mean, there were, Rachel, quite a few people that came out very, very early supporting republican movements, anti-monarchist views, only within hours, in fact, of the Queen's passing. What did you make of that?
I don't think the Australian people have an appetite for those sorts of conversations at the moment. I think we've been plunged into this grief, and it's a very communal grief. I think we want to sit with that, and it's not the time to be talking about political changes.
King Charles, we've heard, is very keen to make the royal family more streamlined. We've heard of the Magnificent Seven. What do you think of that?
I think now with the passing of the Queen, it's natural that the focus will shift not just to King Charles, but really to William in that role as Prince of Wales. That's a historic role, and it's something that we'll see new vigour put into the role that not only William plays, but also his wife Catherine as the new Princess of Wales. And we know Diana was so has such a role in people's hearts here in Australia. So that's going to be quite a poignant moment, I think, Catherine moving into that role. And I think that that will be the focus of the monarchy going forward. It's going to be on the king, but it's also going to be on the prince and the princess of Wales and that next generation with their children.
I think that's an interesting thing that's been slightly overlooked. I mean, the prominence now of Kate and William is going to be quite extraordinary. They've stepped into official capacity, but you get the impression from King Charles that they will definitely be in a very prominent shadow role. Only like he was in the later years toward the Queen, when she was certainly out on her own for many decades. But you get the idea that this is a father and son affair going forward.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, as William and Kate have celebrated their 40th birthdays in recent times, they've really come into their own, and they have a sense of strong responsibility and sort of independent leadership. They know what they want to do with these roles. And I think the Australian people will see a lot more of them in the next decade or so here on our soil. And I think we'll all be looking forward to that.
One question for you. I just wonder whether, as a proud monarchist, are you booking a ticket to go to pay your respects in London?
Unfortunately, I have very young children, so perhaps not. Yeah. But no matter the hour, I'll be up. I'll be watching, and so will many people that I know.
Well, we'll bring it to you live, of course. It's going to be an extraordinary few days ahead. All right, Rachel Bales, thank you for that.
Thank you.
Stay with us. We'll be back with more of our special coverage shortly.
Let's go to Chris Maher now at New South Wales Parliament. Chris, a significant ceremony will take place there tomorrow following the Queen's passing.
Yes, that's right. Tomorrow, the New South Wales proclamation ceremony will occur here at Parliament House, attended by the Premier, the opposition leader, and other senior officials in New South Wales. It is to mark the accession of King Charles III as King of Australia. Now, Macquarie Street here will be shut down for the event. It is not a public event, a very formal one. It will take just 15 minutes, but it's a very significant event in this process in terms of the change at Buckingham Palace.
You've just said thank you very much for bringing Nature Strip to the UK. So it was very special, which is only a matter of months ago. It was the last time I spoke. So, she's a very touching lady, and she touched so many people.
Just, Chris, what you didn't see there was, we just played the wrong clip, that was Chris Waller, the famous horse trainer there, really emotional because he and his wife, Steph, Chris, you can probably fill in the detail, only met the Queen not so long ago when they were given a very special honour in the UK.
Well, they were quite close, in fact, because Chris Waller trains one of the Queen's horses, Chalk Stream, that ran at Randwick last weekend. What you just heard there was Chris Waller describing his final or last conversation with the Queen. That was back in June when she telephoned him to congratulate him the fact that one of his horses, the champion sprinter Nature Strip, had just won at Royal Ascot. Now, today at Rose Hill, at the races, indeed one of the Queen's favourite places, there was a minute's silence for the racing industry to mark her passing. She was, of course, a massive contributor to the racing industry. Racing officials there said that she always appeared at her most relaxed, her most animated at the races. She loved the sport so much. So Rose Hill and indeed also Flemington marking her passing today with minute silence.
Yeah. OK, Chris, thank you very much for that. It's interesting seeing Chris Waller. I mean, he's emotional at the best of times. He loves a winner. He's had a lot of them and he loves his horses and the Queen loved him.